Welcome to Beyond the Data. I'm Dr. Phoebe Thorpe, and here with me today is Alicia Cronquist, a food epidemiologist with the state of Colorado. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
You have a very interesting job at the state of Colorado. Tell me what you get to do.
I coordinate the surveillance and outbreak investigation for foodborne and enteric pathogens.
So when somebody gets sick, you get to figure out what caused it.
We should certainly try to, yes.
That's right. Our session today talks about CIDTs, culture-independent diagnostic testing. Tell me what that is.
Culture-independent diagnostic testing is any sort of laboratory test that detects the antigen or the nucleic acid for the pathogen in question. And it's different from culture, in which you're growing the bacteria on an agar plate.
It tests for a small bit of the bacteria rather than actually growing the whole bacteria.
Yes, that's an important distinction.
Yeah. And that's been helpful because it makes it faster?
There are quite a few advantages to CIDT, or culture-independent diagnostic testing. And the first one, from the patient perspective and the provider perspective and the public health perspective, is that culture-independent diagnostic testing is faster. You can have results in the same day, whereas culture can take 2, 3, or sometimes even longer days.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes you can't culture things.
Right. Another huge advantage of culture-independent diagnostic testing is that it can test for a wider range of pathogens than you can test for with culture. This has been incredibly important with some pathogens already, such as shigatoxin-producing E. coli, where it's revolutionized how we detect, investigate, and control shigatoxin-producing E. coli, or STEC.
So, but it came out in our presentation that there's some disadvantages to using CIDTs instead of cultures. What some of the problems there?
There are several challenges from a public health perspective with CIDT. One of the challenges is that you can't distinguish whether the organism is alive or dead. And so it can detect organisms that have died. So it can't tell you if the patient is still infectious. This is important to us when we're trying to decide if somebody needs to be kept home from school or childcare or kept out of work until they're cleared by public health.
And then there was also some mention about what if you wanted to connect one person's infection to another infection to figure out where the source is.
Right. One of the biggest challenges with CIDT is that it doesn't produce an isolate or a tiny piece of the bacteria that made somebody ill. And these isolates are very, very important to us for a range of public health uses. For example, PulseNet, which we talked about in the presentation as well, but PulseNet helps us to detect infections that might be spread around the country. That is still an isolate-based system. We also do routine subtyping and serotyping and speciation, which helps us to monitor trends by subtype or species over time. So, for example, if we launch an intervention to control Salmonella enteritidis in one part of the food supply, we need isolates to track the Salmonella enteritidis, not just general Salmonella.
Mm-hmm. And it also is important for antibiotic resistance tracking, too?
Yes, at this point, we need isolates to do antimicrobial susceptibility testing. This is important at the patient level to direct patient care, but it's also very important at the population level so we know what type of antibiotic susceptibility we're seeing in foodborne pathogens.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned PulseNet. PulseNet has been around 20 years this year, and it has really thrived because of partnerships. Can you tell me some of what the partnerships are doing to work on these challenges?
PulseNet has been a roaring success, and one of the reasons for that is that clinical laboratories around the country submit isolates, or little pieces of the bacteria, to state public health labs, where public health labs use pulse field gel electrophoresis, or PFGE, and upload those sequences to PulseNet. It has all worked so well because clinical labs have submitted the isolates to us. What we're working on now is making sure clinical labs continue to submit isolates or the clinical material, which is generally stool, to the state public health labs so that we can do the culture and then the pulse field gel electrophoresis.
And that helps them, you figure out what isolates are going around and who might have been infected with them. And how else is that also used, the isolates?
The isolates are used for a really wide range of things. The number one reason is exactly what you say. Isolates are used to detect outbreaks, and without it, we won't have PulseNet working so well to detect foodborne outbreaks. It won't help us to prevent as much disease. Isolates are also used for antimicrobial susceptibility testing so that at a population level, we can make recommendations about what antibiotics are effective and what trends we're seeing. Mm-hmm. And then it also helps us to track serotype-specific surveillance data. So it's not enough for us to say all E. coli is going up or going down, or all Salmonella is going up or going down. We need to monitor a little bit more finely.
Mm-hmm. And there's some technologies that are coming, and the partnership are working together to make the technologies and have a plan. Can you tell me a little bit more about that, where you're going in the future?
With whole genome sequencing, we can detect an even finer level of distinction between the various strains of bacteria that we're tracking. But whole genome sequencing still requires isolates. So while we're taking a great leap forward with whole genome sequencing, we still need isolates, and we still need partnerships with clinical labs and state public health labs to receive isolates or clinical material from them.
Mm-hmm. And then they mentioned some other technologies that are being explored. And so this is kind of a plan to go forward of how to get from incorporate both the CID technology and other technologies that are coming up. Is that what's going on?
That's exactly right. Right now we're in a phase when we still need isolates in the setting of CIDT. We still need to have isolates to do PFGE and whole genome sequencing and antimicrobial susceptibility testing. However, there is quite a lot of work going on to generate the next level of testing where we don't believe we will need isolates anymore. And so we're in an interim stage where we're using a lot of resources and we're thinking hard about how to make sense of our CIDT data and how to still obtain isolates for all the testing we need to do. But we know that there is plans in the future that will move us away from that. We're very excited about that.
This all sounds really exciting, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
And if you want to know more about it, please see our Public Health Grand Rounds. And thank you for joining us.